people see you now. They see you today. Can you give us an idea of what the journey looks like to get to where you are today, to even getting on TV? Is this something that is done immediately, or do you have to work your way up as a writer?
Well, most of us that you see on television, myself, Stephen A. Smith, Skip Bayless, Jemele Hill, Michael Smith, Tony Kornheiser, Michael Wilbon, we all start, Adam Schefter, Adrian Wojnarowski, we all started as writers. And what happened was they began putting writers on television for their information about the teams and the leagues. And those that had good information and those that were comfortable or had some charisma in front of the camera eventually morphed into being full-time television. Rachel Nichols started as a writer like the rest of us. And now I haven't written a word since I've been to Fox Sports. You know, I don't write anymore. I just do TV and radio. So we did start as writers. I would say on the path, number one, do the best you can do in school. That's number one.
Stop there. Is school necessary for what you do?
Yes.
It is necessary.
Unless you are some superstar athlete. I mean, think of all the people you see on television. They all graduated from college other than maybe the superstar athletes, a Charles Barkley, a Shaquille O'Neal, and Alex Rodriguez doing baseball. The normal human being, you generally graduate from college and you study journalism. You don't have to necessarily study journalism, but if you know that's what you want to do, study journalism or broadcast journalism or something like that. So yes, college is necessary. Now, I will say this. When I came out of school in 1990, you had a few paths to get into this field. You either graduated and went to a newspaper, a magazine, a television station, or a radio station. That was it. If you didn't get into one of those four, then you were going to have trouble getting into this profession.
Okay, have times changed
because part of
technology?
Yeah, technology changed it. Because like back in my day, if you apply for a job, they would want to see clips, whether video of you doing your thing or writing what you've written. And there was no way to get those back then other than working for an outlet, a media outlet. So if you weren't working for a media outlet, then you were in trouble. Now, because of technology, this show, everybody can get their own YouTube channel. You can start a blog. You can start a website. You can do a podcast. And those are ways you can, one, gain experience, and two, even have clips or examples. If you were to apply to, say you wanted to apply to BET, you could send them clips of your podcast, you know, and what you've done and how you interview people and all that. So they would get to see that. So it is democratized things, technology, in that there are other ways to get in. Or if you start a website, if your website is so tight and is popping so much that you really start getting a high number of visitors and get, you know, advertisers and stuff, an ESPN or a BET or some bigger outlet might come to you and want to buy your website. Or they might want to hire you to work for their website. Or one of the leagues, the NBA. If you get a certain number of hits on your blog or your website, then you can then go to a league and say, hey, I get 100,000 viewers a month, you know, unique viewers, new viewers a month. And maybe they'll say that's enough to give you a credential to start going to games and covering the team. So now that doesn't happen for all people. It doesn't happen for most, to be honest.
That's what I was about to ask you.
It's just another. It's like, remember Master P and them selling their albums out of the trunk?
Absolutely.
Now that don't work for everybody, but it worked for a few of them. And they were able to make it big. And the big, you know, companies wanted to come and make a deal with them or buy them or whatever. It's the same thing in this business. This is essentially, if you start your own podcast, blog, website, that's essentially you selling your albums out of the trunk. And if you get so big and so popular, then you actually have a door into the quote unquote mainstream.
Got you. Okay, so I'm looking at you, I'm talking to you. This is a 25, 30 year journey you have been on. You're basically saying, look, it doesn't always happen, but you can do it on your own and cut that amount of time. The path that Chris Broussard took, it is not necessarily the only road to get to the destination like it once was. Am I understanding that correct?
Well, it's just different because now, like I said, there were only a few ways to get into the business when I came out. And now there aren't as many newspaper jobs as there used to be. You know, newspapers don't have as many writers as they used to have. But there are these other outlets for you to get into. So I'm saying just with the change in times, the way you get into the business, there are other ways for you to get into it than when I was coming out of school. What I would say is necessary is to go to college. Now there may be, I don't know, is there one person out there that didn't graduate from college or even go to college that's doing it on this level? Maybe. I can't think of one, but maybe that's not an athlete. But for the most part, you need to plan to go to college and, you know, get your degree and move in that way. But, you know, we see kids making money off the internet. You know this. Mm-hmm. YouTube, MC Battles, they making money off. If you get a certain number of viewers, you can make money off of that. So that just gives you another opportunity. But if you're young and you know what you want to do, like I would say to a teenager that knows, I want to be like Chris Broussard or Stephen A. Smith or whatever, you can start your own, these various platforms and get comfortable in front of a camera. Compare what you're doing on your show to Stephen A. or Skip Bayless or Shannon Sharp or whoever, and what you see them doing. You know, hone your speaking skills. I used to write articles and compare them to what I saw in the newspaper. I watch a game on television and write about it and then compare my story to what I saw the next day in the newspaper. So there are various ways you can do it like that too. And it's competitive, as you can imagine. And so you have to be on top of your game and you have to work hard and really grind.
Okay, so my last question to you then. Yes, it's very competitive. There are a lot of people in school right now who are journalists, are majoring in journalism. They love sports. They want to follow in your footsteps. But I'm noticing there are more and more professional athletes that after they leave the game, they're taking a lot of those slots. And I would assume for the networks, that works better because this is a person that the public already knows. Do you feel like there's even more pressure on people who are looking to be the next Chris Broussard? I mean, yeah, that you're not only competing against you, but you're competing against a guy who might retire 2 years from now, and he's looking to sit in front of the camera and be that analyst or be that broadcaster.
Well, number one, that's always been the case. You know, Frank Gifford played pro football. You remember Frank Gifford, Monday
absolutely.
Night Football.
Absolutely, Kathy Lee's husband. John Meredith, but was there as many as it is today, though?
Well, it wasn't because there weren't as many outlets, right? There weren't as many shows. You know, you didn't have cable. We going back before cable television.
Absolutely.
So there always was a high number of athletes, you know, relatively speaking, you know, as there are today. I hear you because you do hear that sometimes from writers that, hey, the athletes are taking all the jobs, specifically a lot of black athletes, because a lot of shows, they'll have a white guy that didn't play, right? And then the brother on the show had to play, right? You know, so there is some of that. But look, the bottom line, man, it's competitive in general. And we're in New York, but let's go to Cleveland, Ohio. You got three teams, the Indians, the Cavs, and the Browns. You've got three television stations, and you basically got two newspapers, Cleveland Plain Dealer and the Akron Beacon Journal. And those are the jobs. So it's a competitive field. You know, not every city has all these teams like New York and, you know, all these different, you know, papers like New York. And even then, because of it's so much more people, it's still very few opportunities.
Correct.
So this, everybody's not, and I hate to say it, but I like keeping it real. Everybody's not going to be on ESPN. Everybody's not going to write at the New York Times. You know, everybody's not going to have their own show. I don't have my own. I have my own radio show. I've never had my own television show. You know what I'm saying? So it's a competitive business, and you just have to, what I say to young people, because it's a lot, like you said, coming out of school. So many are focused on, I want to be the next Stephen A, or I could be up there with Stephen A. I got my opinions. I know the game. I, you know, and you can be so focused. It's good to have goals and ambitions, but don't be so focused on getting to ESPN that you don't excel where you're at. You see, if you're a high school kid, if you're in the South Bronx covering high school sports in the Bronx or in New York, and you like, man, I want to cover the pros. I want to be at ESPN. I want to be at the New York Post, whatever. The way for you to get to the Post or get to the ESPN or cover the pros is to dominate your high school beat. Write the best high school stories. Break the most high school stories. That's when you move up. That's how I moved up, and that's how most moved up. And so that's what I would say. And then the last thing, and this is, I'm going to attribute this to Stephen A. Smith, good friend of mine. Everybody, you know, everybody knows Stephen A. He said it, though. He's like, look, he understands. He's just on television giving opinions. And I'm on television and radio giving an opinion. And you got an opinion. So-and-so got an opinion. So they're like, well, why? How you there and I'm not, right? You have to build up the credibility where people care about your opinion. They care what Stephen A. Smith said. They want to hear what he's going, you know, because he's built up, he covered the league, the NBA for so long. He's wrote a column in Philadelphia about all the sports. I covered the NBA for 26 years. You know, I've, you know, covered some football, covered some baseball. Like, we've built up credibility where people, they've seen us on TV talking about the sports. We know the athletes. We've talked to the coaches. So we have the credibility, and that's where you said the athletes. You know, people been dissing, I don't know if you've seen it lately, dissing Shaq. Oh, Shaq ain't breaking down the game, and Barkley, they don't break up. But do you, so what? They were awesome players, and that gives them credibility. They've been where you and I haven't. They've been in the locker room to hear the Game 7 speech. They know what the butterflies are like before you go play a must-win playoff game. Shaq knows what it's like, what it takes to win championships. That's credibility. And so that's the difference. And so young writers, broadcasters, you've got to build up that credibility. So if you do get on an ESPN or whatever, people care. You know this man in music. I mean, it's a ton of dudes that can rap. Like Mos Def said, the best rapper is a local cat, right? It's all these dudes that can rap, but only so many have credibility and have made them, you know, everybody that raps can't make a great song, you know, and all that stuff. So it's similar in that regard.
Well, I want to end it here. I know you got to go, but you just...
We will do a part two, man. I'm telling you, we'll do a part two because it's been fun.
I'm going to hold you to that, Chris.
Real talk.
You just dropped another gem that I want to bring out to our audience. He said, I know everybody wants, let's just call it, get to the league. Whatever your league is, you want to get to the upper echelon of your industry. But you have to dominate where you're at.
Right.
Everybody wants to jump the line. Everybody thinks that I'm a boss. Nobody wants to be a worker. Everybody wants to be a chief and don't want to be an Indian first. In order to be a great leader, you must be a great follower first. Learn your craft. Dominate where you're at. I love that. Chris Broussard, where can people find you at?
I'm on Instagram at ChrisBroussard68. I'm on Twitter at Chris_Broussard. Anybody wants to email me, real talk, I'll respond. Hit me at king@kingmovement.com. And let me say this. You brought up the King Movement earlier. Yep. We're having a men's conference, Sean, March 19th and 20th. It's virtual. All right? And it's going to be, we got Hall of Fame athletes. We got Tony Dungy. We got Brian Dawkins, remember, defensive back in Philadelphia.
Absolutely.
Hall of Famer. We got Ben Watson, Super Bowl champion. Greg Jennings, Super Bowl champion. Brandon Marshall, all-pro wide receiver, now on Fox Sports 1, first things first. We got Allen Houston, Clark Kellogg. And then we've got pastors. We've got scholars talking about all of them black. There's one, a couple Hispanic and one white scholar, but talking about things like finances, being a husband and a father, diversity, like this racial justice, the fight for racial justice. Talking about even we talked about Christianity, dispelling the notion that Christianity is a white man's religion by talking about Christianity in Africa before slavery and before colonialism. And so we're going to have all that. It's going to be tremendous. We got rappers. We got steppers. So it's virtual. And I would recommend it for any, whether you're a man of faith or not. I mentioned finances. We can all learn about finances. We've been talking about sex, you know, being responsible sexually, you know, and all that stuff. So you can register at kingsummit.org. Kingsummit.org. It's March 19th to 20th, and it's virtual, like I said, so you can watch it on your computer or whatever. And so I just wanted to put that out there. It's going to be great. And you know this, man, we talked about improving the quality of life in our community. We gotta have strong men. Our sisters are doing it. But we ain't going to be a strong people without strong men. And so we want to build up our men. And so that's what the summit is about.
Chris, we'll speak offline. Whatever information you have, flyers, promotional material, please get them over to me. I'm going to blast it out through my platforms and try to get as many people to this summit. I think it is wonderful that you're doing it for the community. Wonderful you're doing it for the men. And it's just something that we need in this community. So if I can help to get more people over there, I absolutely will. Thank you again. Yeah, and you are a true power move maker. Thank you.
Thank you, brother. And we'll do a part two.
I'm holding you to that.
All right. Peace.
Peace. What's up, guys? Thanks for sticking with me to the end of the video. Truly appreciate you. If you like anything you heard here today, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. And if you know anybody that can benefit from this message, feel free to share. Peace and love.